This video and others like it are made possible by the generous support of my patrons on Patreon. If you'd like to help support my channel and get early access to every video, consider becoming a patron at patreon.com/secondthought. If you live in the US and you turned on the news during the week of July 11th, 2021, you were met with breathless, wall-to-wall coverage of supposedly massive anti-government protests in Cuba. If you went on Twitter, you were inundated with hundreds of nearly identical tweets about freedom or how the Cuban people don't want the brutal US sanctions to be lifted, all from accounts created within the previous week. Some of the news footage does indeed show large gatherings, but as we should all know by now, the American media is notorious for twisting the truth. What's really going on in Cuba? And why is the United States government so obsessed with the island nation? In this episode, we'll examine the reality of the protests and take a look at the long history of US intervention in Cuba. Just over 200 years ago, in 1820, Thomas Jefferson called Cuba, quote, "the most interesting addition which could ever be made to our system of states." He went on to say that the United States ought, at the first possible opportunity, to take Cuba. For over two centuries, the American ruling class has had its sights set on Cuba, the island nation just 90 miles off the coast of Florida. This began during the period in which America had become obsessed with the notion of manifest destiny, the idea that American settlers were destined to expand the borders of the empire, originally within the confines of their own landmass, but eventually growing to include places in the farthest corners of the earth. And Cuba, due to its proximity to the United States, was among the very first targets. Cuba's history with the United States is long and complex, but at its core, it boils down to some very simple goals. The United States wanted a captive market for American-style capitalism, and Cuba produced a huge amount of sugar, something which was very valuable to those who held the keys to the industry. After Cuba's war for independence from Spain, the United States initiated a military occupation, amended the Cuban constitution to make it dependent on the US, and established Cuba as a neo-colonial holding. American capital flooded into this new and untapped market, setting up lucrative private enterprises and exploiting the local workers and resources. By 1950, US companies controlled 90% of Cuba's electric and telephone services, 70% of the arable land, 2/3 of the island's sugar production, and 50% of the railways. Only 3% of Cuban farmers owned the land they worked. Quality of life under American colonial rule was abysmal. Nearly a quarter of the population was completely illiterate, life expectancy was just 59 years, and infant mortality was 60 per 1,000. Fast forward a bit, through years of exploitation by American businesses, gangsters, and the US-supported Batista dictatorship, and it should come as no surprise that revolution was inevitable. For a full recounting of US-Cuba relations and all the fascinating details of the Cuban Revolution, I highly recommend you check out Season 2 of Blowback. They're not a sponsor or anything, it's just one of the best podcasts I've ever listened to, hands down. I've left a link in the description and it's well worth your time. For brevity, suffice it to say that the Cuban revolutionaries, led by Fidel Castro, eventually succeeded in defeating the Batista regime, even with their US support, and establishing a government that actually worked for the people of Cuba, rather than their American overlords. Illiteracy was eradicated through education programs, life expectancy increased, and the infant mortality rate plummeted. Today, Cuba enjoys a longer life expectancy than the US, and a lower infant mortality rate, despite 60 years of brutal US sanctions which make it extremely difficult to trade with other nations and acquire medical supplies. That brings us to the embargo. For six decades now, the US has done its very best to crush Cuba's economy. Those in power claim that it's all in the name of human rights, but anyone with even the slightest knowledge of history will know that's not the case. We'll get to that argument shortly. But first, if you're skeptical about the original intent of the blockade, here's an official document from 1960 outlining the recommended actions to cause the collapse of the new Cuban government. This document could not be more explicit. It acknowledges the fact that Castro had majority support. It points out that there was a high likelihood of communism becoming even more popular in Cuba. And it spells out in plain English that the only way to stop this trend is to make Cubans suffer. It says, "The only foreseeable means of alienating internal support is through disenchantment and disaffection based on economic dissatisfaction and hardship." But they don't stop there. The document goes on to say, "It follows that every possible means should be undertaken promptly to weaken the economic life of Cuba. If such a policy is adopted, it should be the result of a positive decision which would call forth a line of action which, while as adroit and inconspicuous as possible, makes the greatest inroads in denying money and supplies to Cuba, to decrease monetary and real wages, to bring about hunger, desperation, and overthrow of government. There you have it. From the US government themselves. A secret campaign to ruin the lives of Cubans, to cause starvation, poverty, and misery, so that the United States could reestablish their brutal colonial rule. In more recent years, calls to end the 60-year blockade have grown. As of the last vote, every single UN member state, with the exception of the United States and Israel, has condemned the blockade as immoral, inhumane, and completely uncalled for. Despite this fact, the blockade remains in place. And the Biden administration has even announced that they will subject Cuba to further sanctions. That brings us to the recent protests. US officials wasted no time in using small, isolated, anti-government protests as an excuse to condemn Cuban leadership, increase economic pressure, and even threaten military intervention. Biden and others have taken to wagging the finger at the Cuban government for their handling of the protests, which is intensely ironic considering the US police and unidentified paramilitary forces brutalized protesters, ran them over with cars, and even kidnapped people and drove them off in unmarked vans during last year's police brutality protests. We have no room to talk when it comes to police interacting with protesters. The US sanctioning of Cuba over, quote, repression of protests less than 1 year after the most brutal government crackdown on the largest protest movement the US has ever seen should be telling. The United States does not care about human rights, nor does it apply the same standards to itself that it sets for other nations. But let's talk about human rights for a moment, then we'll get to the protests themselves. The US is currently calling for investigations into Cuban human rights abuses, while blocking the International Criminal Court from investigating their ally Israel's war crimes. For example, just a few weeks ago, Israeli forces used live ammunition on Palestinian protesters, and Biden didn't even mention it. Israel's treatment of Palestinians has been far, far more brutal and inhumane than arresting a handful of pro-US agitators. Israel's crimes include bombing roads, hospitals, and houses, displacing people whose families have spent entire generations in those homes, and making sure Palestinians can't get clean drinking water, medical supplies, or construction materials to rebuild after the bombings. Of course, the US will never mention this. What about incarceration? US officials love to claim that Cuba is an undemocratic dictatorship. But let's compare records, shall we? Florida was recently ranked the freest state in the US, whatever that means. I'm sure it has nothing to do with the United States trying to cast the closest bit of land to Cuba as its direct opposite. But, in a lovely bit of irony, if Florida were its own country, it would incarcerate a larger percentage of its population than any country on Earth. In second place would be the United States, a country where 74% of prisoners are being held without ever being charged with a crime. This statistic makes it extra despicable when the president tweets things like, "I condemn the mass detentions and sham trials that are the Cuban regime's efforts to threaten the Cuban people into silence." Come on. We wrote the book on mass incarceration and show trials. The United States has the largest prison population, both by sheer numbers and per capita, of any country in modern history. But the US doesn't just operate overcrowded prisons within its own borders. The US also runs an illegal torture complex in Cuba to this day, Guantanamo Bay. As a matter of fact, the first Guantanamo inmate, Abdul Latif Nasser, was just released in July. He had been cleared for release all the way back in 2016, over 5 years ago, and had suffered for 19 years in the American torture prison, without a single charge ever being brought against him. Can you imagine that? Being locked away in a foreign country, not seeing your family, friends, or even your homeland for nearly 2 decades, without ever being charged with a crime. There are still 39 prisoners in Guantanamo Bay. Only 11 of them have ever been charged with anything. It should be very telling that the worst treatment of people in Cuba comes not from the Cuban government, but the American one. Okay, so the US is hypocritical about incarceration and treatment of protesters, but we still help where it counts, right? We must send aid or something to these noble protesters fighting for freedom. Well, no. In fact, President Joe Harm Reduction Biden is increasing harm again by slapping even more unconscionable sanctions on Cuba. US treatment of Cuba is so obviously cruel and inhumane that other nations are ignoring the blockade and sending much-needed aid to Cuba themselves. Mexico has sent ships full of food and medical supplies to help stave off preventable deaths from disease and starvation. Deaths that would not occur without the blockade. That's what caring about the Cuban people really looks like. If the US really cared, we would lift the blockade. We would let the Cuban people determine their own future. But we won't. So if it's not about human rights, what is it about? Let's talk about color revolutions. A color revolution is typically a private-public collaboration between big business and state departments or intelligence organizations with the aim of fomenting political unrest and regime change in target countries. Luna Oy has a couple of good videos explaining the topic more thoroughly. But suffice it to say that the color revolution has been a staple in the US imperial toolbox for a very long time. So, how do you spot one of these phony, often astroturfed protest movements? There are a handful of key components that give them away. The first, and most obvious, is the inclusion of symbols friendly to the imperial power sponsoring the movement. In the case of the recent Cuban protests, note how many protesters are wearing or carrying American flags or English slogans. Also worth noting are the slogans themselves. They're often vague, generic expressions, typically including words like freedom or liberty, words that are guaranteed to elicit a reaction in American viewers, as we saw happen in places like Miami. Color revolutions often tend to be small, especially in places like Cuba, which have so much support for their existing government. And these anti-government protests were very small, despite the US media's attempt to spin them as massive crowds. The giant gatherings we so often saw on TV were actually counter-protests in support of the Cuban Revolution and the government. Here's a video of 100,000 people coming out to say, "No, we don't want US meddling. These agitators do not represent Cuba." Because of this massive disparity in size, mainstream media outlets took to using devious means to convince people the color protests were larger than they actually were. Misleading and doctored photos were widely shared during the protests, those responsible relying on Americans being too ignorant to understand what they were looking at. For example, this photograph was being peddled as an anti-government protest. Except, that's not from 2021 at all. Nor is it even a protest. It's the 2018 May Day Parade. Then there's this. Fox News deliberately lying to their viewers. Surprise, surprise.
So my family, like so many millions of other Cuban families, have seen the brutal oppression of communism firsthand. And I got to say, watching these images, watching Cuban people in the streets, risking their lives when you stand up and protest.
Here's that same clip without the blur. We've seen pictures and videos of crowds where you can clearly see the July 26th flag, the flag supporting the Cuban Revolution and the current government. And those images are being used as evidence that the Cuban people are protesting against the government. Billions of dollars of US meddling over 60 years, and all they can scrape together is a tiny astroturfed protest. Meanwhile, the actual people of Cuba immediately understand what's going on and organize a massive counter-protest in a matter of hours. That's what real support looks like. Grassroots organizing and genuine care for their fellow Cubans and the protection of their revolution against imperialist aggression. But the physical protests were only one front in the war on Cuba. As soon as news of the protests broke, and I mean immediately, Twitter was flooded with brand new sock puppet accounts tweeting near identical messages. Any tweet that mentioned Cuba would immediately get responses from these fake accounts, all saying more or less the same thing. The Cuban people do not want an end to the blockade. The same blockade which is destroying the Cuban economy, destroying lives and livelihoods, and which has been universally denounced except by the United States and its apartheid state lapdog, Israel. Twitter also suppressed pro-government tweets, but allowed the anti-government bot army to freely violate their terms and conditions. If you take all of this into consideration, there is only one conclusion to be drawn. The protests in Cuba were an attempted color revolution by the United States, the country which has been hell-bent on either owning Cuba or destroying it for over 200 years. Now, I'm sure there are some Cubans who genuinely supported the anti-government protests. It would be foolish to assume that all the protesters were actors, plants, or otherwise compensated by the US. But it's important to understand that their genuine frustrations are all entirely the fault of the United States and our trillion-dollar blockade on their country. Even with the crippling sanctions, the Cuban government has done very well for their people and enjoys tremendous support. Imagine what they could do if the blockade were lifted. And that is exactly why it won't be. The US is alone in its demonization and inhumane treatment of Cuba. Even the New York Times, a staunchly capitalist outlet, allowed the printing of a full-page ad demanding an end to the 60-year blockade, signed by over 400 politicians, intellectuals, clergy, activists, and former heads of state. It should be clear by now why the most powerful country on earth refuses to let another sovereign nation pursue its own development in its own way. The United States has always been, and always will be, terrified of the possibility of another economic system challenging the myth of capitalist superiority. If a socialist nation can prove itself anywhere in the world, and especially so close to home, the US will do its very best to destroy it and bend that nation to the will of global capitalism. If the President of the United States, the bastion of capitalism, has to go on TV twice in 1 week and defend capitalism as a viable economic system, you know they're getting worried. Socialism is trending upward, and American faith in capitalism is on the decline. It's no surprise we're seeing a massive surge in Cold War rhetoric and anti-communist propaganda on every news network and from every elected official. And it's why we'll continue to see more color revolutions like the one in Cuba going forward. Keep an eye on Latin America. That region will be the front lines in the fight against imperialism and capitalist domination. During the AstroTurf protests, the State Department Twitter account tweeted out a touching commemoration of Nelson Mandela, a man universally hailed as a great moral person. This, of course, is incredibly ironic considering the harsh words Mandela had for the US, and the fact that he admired and respected Fidel Castro, whom the United States demonizes to this day. For example, during apartheid, Mandela said of the US, "We are being advised about Cuba by people who supported the apartheid regime. No honorable man or woman could accept such advice." Biden has called Cuba a failed state and communism a failed system. Meanwhile, in the US, we are indoctrinated to see stories like this one as heartwarming. In Cuba, despite 60 years of backbreaking US sanctions, 7-year-olds don't have to sell lemonade to pay for their brain surgery, because healthcare is free. They have a much lower incarceration rate, a near-zero homelessness rate, and overwhelming support for their government. The United States is grasping at straws. Our sadistic imperialist regime is desperate not to let a left-wing government and economy just off our coast grow large and prosperous enough to offer Americans an alternative to the ever-worsening capitalist status quo. If US leadership really believes communism is a failed system, let it fail. Lift the blockade and watch it implode if you really believe it will. The United States does not care about the Cuban people. It has oppressed, exploited, occupied, and economically strangled another sovereign nation for entire generations. This will continue forever unless popular mass movements at home and abroad force US leadership to do the right thing. We have no right to sentence an entire country to a slow and painful death. When oppressed peoples around the world stand up and demand a better life, take note of the symbols they choose. It's certainly not the American flag. In every instance of oppressed populations standing against imperial aggressors, it's communist symbols they carry. And in every effort to crush those movements, the American flag leads the way. The Cuba protests represent a gut-check moment for Western leftists. If you call yourself a socialist, but you spend all your time arguing with communists, demonizing socialist states as authoritarian, and performing apologetics for US imperialism, if your take on Cuba aligns with Joe Biden, Marco Rubio, and Ron DeSantis, I think some introspection is in order. Cuba must be free to forge its own path, determine its own future, and it must be freed from the shackles of US imperialism and capitalist oppression. I mentioned at the beginning of this video that this kind of content is made possible by my patrons on Patreon. When I decided to make the shift from general interest stuff to more radical political content, I knew I ran the risk of sinking my channel and losing my ad revenue and sponsors. These days, it's pretty hard to get a sponsor on my videos. I have one reliable one, and they're great. But for the most part, I'm having to rely on the generous support of viewers like you. If you appreciate the work I'm doing, and you're able to chip in even a dollar a month, I would greatly appreciate the support. As a little show of that appreciation, every patron, regardless of donation amount, gets early access to every video, as well as access to our patrons-only Discord server. It's a great place to hang out, chat with other like-minded people, or learn about socialist theory in our book club. I'm also pretty active in the server, so you're always welcome to ping me to ask a question or just say hi. You can find my Patreon, join our growing Discord server, and get early access to every video at patreon.com/secondthought. If you enjoyed this video, consider dropping a like. If you hated it, a thumbs down. You can check out my previous videos by clicking the links on your screen. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you next week.